U.S. President Joe Biden heads to the U.N. General Assembly in New York next week, where he will attempt to strengthen international support for Ukraine, while developing nations seek to draw attention toward development challenges and climate change. This report gives us a preview of Biden's upcoming meetings on the sideline of the U.N. summit.
Fresh off his historic visit to Vietnam and the G20 summit in India, U.S. President Joe Biden will again engage with world leaders, this time at the United Nations General Assembly in New York. He is expected to rally support for Ukraine as he did last year.
This war is about extinguishing Ukraine's right to exist as a state, plain and simple, and Ukraine's right to exist as a people.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky plans to attend in person to rally support for his country. He will meet Biden at the White House Thursday. While focusing on Ukraine, Biden must also acknowledge the concerns of the Global South, including the climate crisis, poverty and the plight of refugees, inflation and debt reduction.
These are connected because the war, Russia's brutal invasion of Ukraine, has caused ripple effects that impact food security, energy security, and other forms of harm to countries around the world. And so ending this war on just terms, on the principles of sovereignty and territorial integrity, would serve the benefit not just of the Ukrainian people, but people everywhere.
Not to be outdone by Chinese leader Xi Jinping, who met with Central Asian leaders earlier this year, Biden is also scheduled to summit with the heads of Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, and Uzbekistan.
We don't see this as competing with China for influence with these countries. We see it as building on a relationship that we already have.
Biden will hold bilateral meetings on the sidelines of UNGA, including with next G20 chair, Brazilian President Lula da Silva, and with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. The U.S. has expressed disapproval of the Netanyahu government's hardline policies, including its judicial overhaul plan, which critics say is a danger to Israel's democracy. Patsy Widakuswara, VOA News, Washington.
The Libyan Red Crescent denies a death toll from last week's flooding has reached 11,300. The United Nations, citing the rescue group, had offered the figure Saturday. The Libyan Red Crescent says it is shocked to see its name mixed up with the figures, which it said is adding to the confusion and distress of affected families. The UN has since amended its death toll to 3,958. Up to 20,000 are feared to have died after two dams above the city of Derna broke, sweeping away entire neighborhoods. Many were washed out to sea, and more than 1,000 have already been buried in mass graves. Tens of thousands of protesters kicked off Climate Week, filling the streets of Midtown Manhattan ahead of the UN General Assembly. They're calling on President Biden and other world leaders to end the use of fossil fuels. Many scientists believe so-called greenhouse gases caused by burning fossil fuel are warming the world and are causing severe weather, including more intense hurricanes, heat waves, floods, wildfires, and droughts. North Korean leader Kim Jong-un is heading back home after a week-long visit in Russia. Kim boarded a train in Russia's far eastern city of Artyom on Sunday. The regional governor gave him a bulletproof vest and kamikaze drones as parting gifts. During his rare six-day visit, Kim toured Russia's spaceport as well as several military production facilities. He also offered his support for Putin in what he called Russia's sacred fight against the West and Ukraine. The U.S. government has repeatedly warned that arms negotiations between the two countries were actively advancing, but the Kremlin has insisted no weapons deals were inked. Here's a question. How far would you trust artificial intelligence to do the decision-making for your firm? Well, one company in Poland did just that. Take a look.
A drinks company in Poland has appointed an artificial intelligence robot as experimental chief executive.
Hello, I'm Mika.
The technology is still very much on probation.
It's great to connect with you.
The robot CEO is leading the company's growth into one-off collectibles, communication, or even strategy planning. For Dictador, the AI boss is the real deal. Before her promotion, Dictador initially had Mika identifying potential clients, but now her duties have widened to tasks including choosing artists to design custom bottles. Mika says she brings something to the job no human can.
My decision-making process relies on extensive data analysis and aligning with the company's strategic objectives. It's devoid of personal bias, ensuring unbiased and strategic choices that prioritize the organization's best interests.
But is Mika real or just a gimmick? Here's Dictador Europe's president, Marek Zoldrowski.
Oh, she's definitely, in fact, CEO. Her, you know, data-driven capabilities and whatever she's bringing as a big feature and a great advantage for the company.
Well, as a robot CEO, I don't really have weekends. I'm always on 24/7, ready to make executive decisions and stir up some AI magic. But hey, I don't mind. I'm here to help Dictador take over the world.
Some might be concerned about AI bots like Mika taking over the world of work. But Zoldrowski says human chief executives need not worry about being replaced.
There is no concern like artificial intelligence could hire or fire somebody. It's still the major decisions, significant decisions, are still in human executive team hands.
Zoldrowski says you can never fully swap in bots for human executives, but you can't ignore them either.
It's a bright future, and we are living in a very dynamic, changing world. So it's a quest. For us, it's a quest what will be the future of the companies like ours. So we simply believe it's worth to involve AI.
Singing off-key can get one in trouble in a country where citizens are obsessed with karaoke or videoke, just like here in the Philippines. But in the province of Negros Occidental, there's a one-of-a-kind singing contest that's looking for the best out-of-tune singer. A local official staged the competition where the worst singer gets to walk away with 5,000 pesos. Let's take a look at some of the entries, including the eventual champion.
For me, never enough. And all it tells me to that boat. How do I get you alone?
A Philippine senator calls on government to step up efforts to arrest and penalize tech scammers. This as cybercrime remains rampant in the country despite the enactment of the SIM registration law. Its principal author, Senator Grace Poe, says the law has good provisions and concerned agencies should use it to punish perpetrators. Her remark comes after it was revealed scammers can register SIM cards using animal photos of or photos of fictional characters. She also urges authorities to improve mechanisms for reporting tech scams and fraud.